Welcome everyone to Power Up Learning with Task Cards. I'm Laura Candler from Teaching Resources, and Rachel Lynette from Minds and Bloom is here with me this evening, and we are so excited to share with you about task cards and how to really make an impact with task cards in your classroom. So many of you may be familiar with me or know something about me. You're familiar with my website. I have a website that I've had for quite a number of years called Teaching Resources, and then more recently a blog, Corkboard Connections. I'm a former elementary teacher. I taught fourth and fifth grade for 30 years between those two grades, and I retired a few years ago, but I stay very active with creating resources for teachers, and I, you know, I love sharing ideas with teachers and helping to develop materials that make teachers' lives a little easier, save them time. So this is a picture of me reading aloud to my students. I really loved reading aloud in my classroom. So Rachel, I'm going to see if I can advance the slide, since it's just one slide for you here.
Great. So I'm Rachel Lynette. I'm also a former elementary school teacher. I've been blogging since 2009. In addition, I've written about 120 nonfiction books for kids on all kinds of topics. I've written some books for Evan Moore. And there's my blog, Minds in Bloom, which has been recently redesigned. And, of course, I sell task cards and other resources on Teachers Pay Teachers. When I was teaching, I taught a lot of gifted, usually third and fourth grade. I also have taught some science, and I have run the technology, the computer room, and been that technology teacher for a few years. And I think that's pretty much it. I love creating task cards and other resources. Oh, and this picture is of me. I was one of the keynote speakers at the conference that Teachers Pay Teachers does for teacher authors. And that was just last year, and it was very exciting.
Awesome. Oops, I went the wrong way. That's one of the problems with the clicker that I'm using. I'm using a remote pointer, and sometimes I go the wrong way. Okay, so you might be wondering, you know, are you in the right place right now, and do you want to spend the next 90 minutes or so with us? If you missed the introduction actually before the webinar, I shared that last night, this webinar, Rachel and I presented it, and actually took 2 hours. And we knew that it was packed full of great strategies. We really did not know that it was going to be 2 hours. But when we asked folks at the end, you know, what should we cut out, they said, don't cut anything out. Just let people know ahead of time. And I did put that in the emails that were going out today. So you may have to grab, you know, a snack or something, and then just, you know, take care of your needs or whatever. Stand up from time to time if you need to. But I think you're going to find it's well worth your time. So if you can relate to these, any of these statements, then you are in the right place tonight. So if you're thinking task cards are awesome, but I really need some fresh strategies, then we have lots of stuff for you. If you're thinking, I've never used task cards and I really have no idea where to begin with them, we have a lot for you. If you hate boring test prep worksheets and you wish there was a fun way to review that's also effective, we have something for you. And if you've actually tried them before and you really weren't too thrilled about it, been there, done that, you know, I've tried task cards and I really can't figure out why everyone loves them, we have a lot for you too, because it might come down to just the strategies that you're using or needing a few more tools in your toolkit or some classroom management or whatever. So we will be covering all of these this evening. The other thing I wanted to mention is that you should have these notes handy. I've sent out some links to them, and then there's a link at the bottom of the page if you don't have them. I think it'll be a great place to jot down some of the key points and kind of help you see where we are. There's also a professional development certificate that's available in several places, but it is on the freebies page that I'll share with you at the end. It's kind of a do-it-yourself model, but you know, this is a long presentation and packed full of resources, and if you take notes throughout it and then download this certificate, you may find that you can get credit for this from your administration. So here's what you're going to learn today. We're going to share strategies for powering up any task card lesson, 5 key questions to ask when planning task card activities, how to choose the right type of task card for the lesson. Wait, there's more. 6 cooperative learning task card strategies to boost learning. Tips for using task cards in games. Quick and easy assessment strategies. And why teachers and kids love task cards. And I think by the time we go through the webinar and get to the end of it, you will already know why teachers and kids love task cards. But we're going to be sharing some ideas that we've asked in the task cards Facebook group. So, Rachel, I think this is your chance to take it over, and I will give you the keyboard and the mouse control.
All right, and we'll hope that this works. Sometimes it takes a little bit of lag time. So I'm going to do this very quickly just for people who are perhaps completely new to task cards. And maybe I'm going to do this really quickly because it's not popping up. Oh, there we go. Yay, I love it when that happens. Okay, so over here we've got a worksheet. And we're all very familiar with worksheets. This is one of Laura Candler's. And over here, this is kind of a way just to illustrate that you can take like one of these questions and put it on a task card. So this is a sheet of 6 task cards, and each one is its own little nugget, as you can see, because you can break them up, maybe. Ah, it's not wanting, there it goes. Yeah, oops, I want to go back now. So what happens is I don't wait for the lag time. Okay, I will get better at this. So we've got each one in its own little place, and so you can think of task cards. One way to think of them is worksheets in bite-sized chunks, but task cards come in lots of different flavors, and we are going to be talking about that. So I would like to talk about the different kinds of task cards, because when you know the different kinds of task cards, it'll do two things for you. First of all, immediately, you'll know what I'm talking about when I say multiple choice or short answer in this, and what Laura's talking about in this presentation, and also we'll be talking about which ones work best for each activity or lesson. So I'm going to do this really quickly because you should be familiar with this. So these are multiple choice task cards. They come in several different types. Some are very easy. Some have longer answers. They're great for games. They're easy to correct because usually the answers are just A, B, C. And they are excellent for test prep because often they look just like the test. And then we've got short answer. These usually require, as it says, a short answer. They're a good way to increase the rigor and differentiate because often it's much harder to pull that answer out of your own head. They can be open-ended, which is something that you can't do with a multiple choice. And they sometimes don't have directions. They're just sort of the challenge, like this math problem here, this multiplication one. The next one is discussion prompts or questions, and these are great because you can use them in so many ways. And these are both free resources, which will be on your resource sheet at the end. I'm really excited about my friendship cards over here because so many counselors and teachers have told me that they really, really have helped students who are having trouble socially. And so I always like to talk about those. Those are great for discussion and writing. And Laura has something that, actually we'll talk about that right now, works really well for text-based discussion. And this is a social studies task card. As you can see, it goes with this book over here in social studies. I think you can see my mouse right here. So this is about this book specifically. And so that would be terrific for discussion or for writing. And they're really fun for team building. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that because I want to talk about how great task cards are for when you're doing literature circles or reading. So first of all, if you teach fourth or fifth or sixth grade, I really hope that at some point in your kids' upper elementary school career, they're reading Wonder. Please, please, please read Wonder with your students. Such a great book. And if you do read any book, you might be able to find a set of task cards to go directly with that book, like these Wonder task cards. But if you can't find a set of task cards to go with your book for discussion or writing, you can use more general ones. I have a set called Lit Sparks, and these questions will go with pretty much any book that you want that you might have. And Laura also has a set of more general discussion questions, but she has this set, which goes, oh, I thought we had another card. I think it's going to pop up now. There it is. It was in a different order before. This one's a free set, and this particular set goes with Emma's Dilemma, and so that's great, but they don't have to go with books. Would you rather questions are awesome for discussion. Kids love these things, and you can even ask them more than once. You can ask them at the beginning of the year and the same ones later at the end of the year. Great for any time you have a few minutes or you want to use a writing prompt or a class poll. Here's a set of free end-of-the-year questions. There, I know I have a lot of prompts, general writing prompts. Laura has some, and so I hope that you will use those. So those are prompts. Other task card formats, cards that for a specific activity. So these two cards, which the first one is Fluency Fun. All you're doing is reading that. The students are reading this task card to practice fluency, to get better at their reading fluency. And so there's no answer key. And then, of course, Brain Break, same thing. It has a specific activity. It's all about the Brain Break, and it's not a thing with an answer key or anything like that. It's not a writing activity. And then cards related to a specific resource, Laura has some. Right here with her sentence go-round. So these cards just have very simple sentences on them, two or three words, the ball rolled. And then the challenge, of course, is to add your adjectives and your adverbs, maybe change the verb, and make a much better, more interesting sentence. And that's what these cards are for, and they're for this one specific. They go with a specific resource. And I think we're going to flip. Okay, so now that we know the types of task cards, and you know, you might want to just take a minute and think about the types of task cards you've used and which kind are your favorite, and if you want to input, it's always interesting to know if people like prompt cards or those multiple choices better. But now that you know the basic types, we're going to talk about questions that you want to ask yourself while you're lesson planning so that you will choose the right task card for the job, for the lesson, because sometimes you can run into these sort of awkward classroom management issues if you don't choose the right format. So the first one is very basic. This is Education 101. What am I trying to accomplish? We all know that you want to look at your standard and your objective and all that, but I would like you to think in terms of what you want to accomplish with those task cards. Are you going for practice reinforcement and remediation? Because if you are, you're probably going to want short answer or multiple choice. But like this one, this is great for practice and reinforcement. You've taught your kids about word roots. Now they're going to be practicing identifying word roots, or actually identifying what they mean. Or are you digging deeper? If you're digging deeper, you might want a prompt card like this one. This is an activity where they are going to compare themselves to the main character using a T-chart. So that's clearly digging deeper into character when you're reading a book. Maybe you are doing assessment, and with an assessment, you probably want multiple choice again, or maybe short answer. In this particular picture, this little girl is using clickers, which Laura is going to be talking about a little bit more soon. What you don't generally use task cards for is for teaching a new concept. Now, it could be that some people do, but I really haven't seen it much. Generally, you want, as the teacher, want to introduce a concept. And then you are using those task cards for one of these three things, to reinforce or to dig deeper or assess. You're not really teaching it using the task cards because it tends to be, it just isn't the best way to teach a new concept. Okay, so the next question you want to ask is, what's my ideal group size? Are you going to be working with the whole class at once? Are you going to be dividing kids into small groups or cooperative learning teams? And on that question, are you going to be dividing them up into, are you going to have one small group that you're working with while everybody else is doing something independently, or are you dividing your whole class into small groups? Are you going to be working in partners, maybe another cooperative learning type activity? Or are your students working individually? The next question you'll want to ask is, do I need a record of student responses? What format do you want that record to be in? Do you want an answer sheet? And if so, what kind of an answer sheet do you want? So this is a pretty basic answer sheet from Laura. And then I wanted to show you that you don't always want to use one for all your task cards. If you've got task cards that go a little in depth, you might want to use a different format. So these are editing task cards, and there's 200 of them in the resource, but they come in sets of four, and each four is about a different nonfiction topic. So these ones are about dinosaurs, and each of these sentences is about dinosaurs, and they all have three mistakes in them. And so what you would do is write dinosaurs in the banner, and then in each of these bubbles, the student would write the card number, and then on the lines, they would rewrite the sentence correctly, correcting each of those three mistakes. And this particular page is for four different cards, for the four that are presented here. So that's another way to do answer sheets. Now, you don't always need a record. Your kids are going to do a lot of things that you just don't need records for. When they're playing games, when they're doing movement activities sometimes, your students are going to multiply 5 times 6 many, many times, and you do not need a record of every time they do it. The next question is, do I want my students to move or stay seated? I really hope the answer is, in most cases, I want them to move, especially if you're doing test prep. Especially if you have those wiggly kids. Boy, movement can be such a lifesaver, and I know you all know that your student that's causing so much trouble can become a star if you just get them up and let them move. And we also all know that moving is really good for learning. You probably want to be seated if you're doing an activity that's more than a few sentences of writing or if you're having a discussion. And let's see, this should be switching. Yes. How will answered be checked? And this is kind of a two-parter. First, you want to think about who's going to be checking those answers. Are you going to do a group check where you're all checking together or where students are comparing answers? Are you going to do a partner check with partners either checking an answer key or talking together? Are you going to have students self-check? Maybe you give them access to an answer key and you have a routine, a specific routine they follow where they do the work and then they check their own answers. And, of course, you can have your helper check, your parent volunteer, or you can check it. And I hope that for especially things like multiple choice, I hope you're finding a parent to help with that and that you're not taking it home. But sometimes I know that's what has to be done. And the other question on this is the method that it will be checked. And there's some great ways. You know, the first thing we do is we go to an answer key, right? There'll be an answer key. But that's not the only way you can check task cards. You can also scan digitally with clickers and QR codes, and this is an example of somebody using clickers. Again, Laura will talk about that soon, and you can see this QR code with this time card down here. Another option is for math. You can have your students check with calculators, and now they're practicing calculator use, which is a great skill. Or if you really want to add a whole other level of depth to an activity, then you could have them consult a reference book with some types of task cards. Laura is going to come and she is going to talk about how we can power up task cards.
Rachel shared with you those 5 key questions about planning, but we're going to dig even deeper into this. A lot of people think that task cards are just fun. They're just kind of fluff. And we know that they're way more than that. So we're going to dig into how to power up task card lessons and make them even more effective. But before we do that, we need to look at regular, like any lesson. How do you make any lesson more powerful? So I want you to think for a moment about a great lesson that you taught. It might have been last week, it might have been a few weeks ago, but if you get in mind a day when at the end of the day you were just really energized because you knew it was a great lesson, and not only did the kids have fun, they learned a lot. If you think about that, I bet you that lesson had a couple of things going for it. It was probably engaging or fun for your kids. They were real excited about it. But if you're like me, that's not enough to have a good lesson or a great lesson, because sometimes kids have a lot of fun, but they're really not learning anything. And the next day, they cannot tell you anything as far as what they were supposed to learn. So they score poorly on a quiz or whatever. They didn't retain it. So I have come to realize that for a lesson to be really powerful, it has to be more than fun. It needs to be challenging or rigorous. And when you put those together, you can really power up lessons and make them great. So let's dig into those two aspects of a powerful lesson or activity. If you want to ask yourself, what does it mean for something to be fun? This, in my experience, if it's a game or it's kind of like a game, it's usually going to be very fun or engaging. Now, everything doesn't have to be a game, and I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if it does happen to be kind of like a game, that does make it more fun. Will your kids be actively engaged? Are they going to be moving? Will they be allowed to talk? Are they going to be manipulating something? That always makes it more fun. And would they want to do that activity if they had a choice? So if you said, we can do this or we can do something else, would they say, no, we want to do this? Then you know that your activity is fun. And I do remember some lessons and some activities. Mystery number is an activity that comes to mind that my students didn't even want to go outside for recess. They were having so much fun, but it was very challenging too. So, you know, that's kind of how I think about whether something's fun. Now, is it rigorous? Will it make your students think? Will it challenge them in some way? Does it involve higher level thinking, such as strategizing, analyzing? And, you know, there's lots more things that you can consider, but that's sort of what I'm talking about with rigorous. So I kind of put these ideas together. I'm a visual learner, so I like to think about this visually. So if you think of a square shaded yellow, and as shown here, and you think of the dark yellow area would be where the more fun activities are, and the less fun lessons would be on the left side in the lighter colored area. And then if you think about rigor as a blue box from top to bottom, and up at the top in the dark area is something that's more rigorous, and something that's, you know, very basic, less rigorous would be at the bottom. And if you overlay those two squares and then divide it into quadrants, and if you think about yellow and blue making green, it kind of comes together in this interesting matrix, and you have this on your handout, but it's just black and white. So if you look at the factors of rigor and fun, you know, if you start in this lower left corner, if you have something that's not very fun and not very rigorous, like a skill and drill type worksheet, it's not fun and it's really easy, that there's not a lot of learning going on. If you look at something that's not really very fun, but it is more rigorous, like maybe test prep activities, there's learning going on, but a lot of times kids won't retain it because it's just not fun and they're not engaged in it. And then if you go to the lower right corner, sometimes you have things like science activities that are like lots of fun, but they're just real easy. They don't really require the kids to write or talk or think about what they're learning. And so it's fun, but not a lot of learning is happening. But if you can find something, create a lesson that's really fun, but really gets the kids thinking, talking, analyzing, and just challenges them mentally, that's really the sweet spot for learning. And that's just, you know, kind of my experience. I didn't get this anywhere. It's just kind of, I was thinking about it a few months ago, like what makes a really great lesson. And I've been applying it to different situations and different webinars that I've been teaching, and it just really seems to hold up and be meaningful. So what we want to do now, that was like, how do you power up any lesson? What we're going to do now is take task card lessons and kind of combine that idea with what Rachel was talking about earlier about those key questions. And she is going to start by covering these aspects of powering up task cards. And then after she does that, then I'm going to come in with some cooperative learning strategies and some games and assessment. So Rachel, I'm going to click over to the next slide and see if I can give you back the presenter control. And wait just a second. Let me mute myself and take it away.
Okay, we will see if it has some lag time before I get some control here. That's the way it usually works. There we go. Okay, so the first thing you can do to really power up task cards is you can require students to justify their response. And I know this is something that a lot of you are already doing. So just as an example, this is an informational text structure and task card. And the goal here is to identify which text structure this paragraph was written in. And there's four multiple choices here. And that's what they're supposed to do. But of course, it becomes much more rigorous if you say, well, why? Why is this? This is a compare and contrast. It's moths and butterflies. Why is it compare and contrast? What are the clue words? What gave you the hints? How do you know? And you could do that in writing, or you could do that orally. And it, again, works great with paragraph cards. So one possibility is to have students do a certain number of them together as a group, and then to have them choose one or two that there are, or you choose one or two that they're then going to use in their interactive notebooks or journals that they're going to do some writing on. Another way to differentiate, it's easy to differentiate with task cards because each one is its own little nugget of learning, and I'm just using this slide to point that out, that you can differentiate because they're not all on one sheet. And so one way to differentiate, taking that idea into this concept, is that you can have the same topic but use different levels, because maybe you've got kids who are second language learners or students that are struggling or they're special eds, or you might have other kids on the other side of the scale that are gifted And so you want to differentiate for that, and even for the time of year. So these are restate the question task cards. The idea is to get that skill of restating the question that students need to have. So the one on the left is really easy. What number should you call if there is an emergency? You should call 911 if there's an emergency, or if there's an emergency, you should call 911. That's not too difficult, but maybe towards the end of the year, your third graders, they're going to be fourth graders soon and they need a bigger challenge, or you've got some GAT kids. With this one, it's a two-part question, and they need to use the word because. What is your favorite season? Why is it your favorite? My favorite season is spring because I love to watch the flowers bloom. That is a much harder thing to do. And so that's one way you can do. That's one example. And another example over here is a much clearer example. These are Laura's division task cards. And as you can see, we've got three different levels here. And you could use these at different parts of the year with different math levels. If you have a third, fourth, a split class, this could be a great way to go. Another thing you can do is you can mix them up. So maybe it's the end of the year, and you're two level C, but you could throw in some A's and B's in there just so that kids don't, they probably won't forget how to do two digits, but they might. So you can also mix them up or use them, and so that's a great way to differentiate. We should be switching here. There we go. So most task cards are designed for a specific purpose with instructions, but you can totally use them in alternate ways, and that's what we're going to talk about right now. I actually saw somebody talk about this in the questions. One thing you can do is you can alter the task card by putting tape over the multiple choice. So this is a multiple choice task card, and I'm just going to read it because we're going to talk about it for a minute. She walked into my office like she owned the place. I could tell she had money and lots of it. My husband has disappeared and you must find him as soon as possible, she said. Business had been slow for weeks and I was happy to take the case. Well, you probably have all figured out which genre this is. It might be a little more challenging for third graders, but it's a little easier because under that tape, they've got, some choices. Maybe science fiction, historical fiction, contemporary, and of course, mystery. You can make that a lot tougher if you cover them up because now they've got to come up with that out of their own heads. Now you can make this easier by leaving that tape off and instead putting a little clue on the back. So this is the same card, and on the back with a vis-a-vis or a dry erase, you can write a clue. Who's narrating the story? So now a child who's stuck or a pair that's stuck, they can look and they can say, well, who is narrating the story? Well, it's somebody with an office. It's somebody who takes cases. This person's got a disappearing husband. Boy, that sounds like a private detective. I wonder if this is a mystery. So that can really help. Another thing you can do is you can use alternative answer sheets, and you can make these yourselves. So this is a set of find the theme task cards. These are pretty challenging. They have a story. There's no question on the task card. It's just the story. And their job is to find the theme of the story. Now, this is the harder answer sheet because they have got to pull that theme from what they know and from what they read. They've got to infer that theme. That's challenging. If you want to make it a little easier, if you're introducing theme, one thing that you could do is you could use this other answer sheet, and there's no reason why you can't make one like this if your resource doesn't come with one. So now there's multiple choices on the actual answer sheet. This is number 7, this is the one that we covered up here. And when you see the three choices here, it's much, much easier to figure out which one is the theme. And you can mix that up. You could do some that have the multiple choice and some where they have to come up with it out of their own heads. Another thing you want to do is make sure that you're giving your students a just right number of task cards. So you're going to want to present a good idea is often to present one or two at a time for struggling learners. For example, these are solve it task cards and these are test prep. I actually made these in conjunction with the principal and we used past standardized tests. They are pretty challenging, and if you have a struggling learner and you put 32 of these things in front of him or her, that's going to feel pretty overwhelming. But if they're just working on one at a time, so much better. And then you also feel that great feeling of accomplishment. I finished this one before you have to look at the next one. Another thing that you can do is you can assign more or less task cards as needed. It might be that your struggling learner needs, if it's one concept, maybe it's homophones or word roots, maybe that may or verbs, maybe that learner needs you know, the whole stack of 32 to really get that concept, and maybe they need to do it twice. Whereas your GAT kid or a kid who really gets it, maybe 10 cards is enough, and there's no reason to make that student run through all 32. And this is just an example of, this is one of Laura's task cards, and unlike the solvents, this is a simpler concept. And so with this one, you could probably put a stack of 32 in front of a student, and they wouldn't feel too overwhelmed because there's just two answer choices, and it's a more simple concept to fill in the blank. So you want to differentiate either way. Another thing you can do is change the directions. Task cards come with directions often. This one is to choose the whether it's a fragment, a run-on, or a complete sentence. My mom's delicious cream cheese brownies. Well, obviously that is, for us, it's obvious, maybe not for third graders, it's a sentence fragment. But you know, you could add to that or give a different assignment. Now what they need to do is they need to make the group of words into a complete sentence if it's not one. So now it's my mom's delicious cream cheese brownies were the hit of the bake sale. Or everyone loves my mom's delicious cream cheese brownies. You can even do it two ways. If it's a run-on sentence, maybe they make it into two or three sentences. With this one, this is author's purpose. That's the goal, find the author's purpose. But there is no reason that students can't find the main idea in this paragraph. This is a great one for main idea. They can summarize this paragraph. They can paraphrase this paragraph. They can form questions. This one's about pufferfish. To get those questioning skills going. So feel free to multi-purpose your task cards. You don't have to just use them for whatever it says. Some more examples. This is Laura's telling time task card. So, you know, the obvious thing here is, what time is it? But you could also have students write the time in words. They could say what time it will be in 30 minutes. You can add another task card. And now we're working with elapsed time between the clocks. And if you really want to give those guys a challenge, write an elapsed time word problem using these two task cards. Another thing you can do is you can use challenge cards. Now, I'm just going to toot my own horn. As far as I know, I was the first person to make challenge cards with my task cards. I may be one of the only ones. I honestly don't look at other people's sets all that much. But almost all of my task cards have at least one, and often they have up to four or five or even six challenge cards to go with them. And a challenge card is a card that can be used to extend the learning, usually with every other card in the set. So this is a homophone activity. Your job is to figure out which homophone goes in that sentence. But this is a challenge card that goes with this, and the challenge is to use both of the homophones on the card in one sentence. So, and underline the homophones, of course. So with this one, I had to haul the heavy suitcase down the hall. Now, I did this with a group of third graders once, of gifted third graders, and we did them on sentence strips, and the kids wrote sentences, and we put them all over a big wall, made a big sentence wall with it, word wall, and it turned out to be really a great activity. The students really enjoyed the challenge of getting both homophones in the same sentence, and sometimes three homophones for, you know, there, pair, pair, pair. And they also really, it was a good resource to have that wall full of homophones used in context. Here's another example. These are tile tangle cards. These are really fun. You're making words with these tiles, and they're Scrabble tiles, and then you are adding up your score for each word and then adding up the score for the entire card. So you've got some math. Well, if you want to step up the math, and I would recommend that you only do this with one or two cards. You certainly wouldn't want to do it with all 32, or you would have your students going insane. But what if your new challenge on this card, say, is to double the point value of all the letters that are made with only straight lines? So that's going to be what? A, T, L, not R, not J, W, and I. All those are going to be double, and when you make your point, when you make a word, so you're making the word jar, you've got to figure out which of those, you know, or jaw, that's a better one because it's got a straight line, and your total for that word is going to be different. And now you've got a really lovely math activity that would make a really great fast finishers or center activity. So definitely, if your set of task cards doesn't come with challenge cards, there's no reason that you can't make your own. Okay, I have talked a little bit about that, and Laura has more to share with us now. And so she's going to come in. And I'm not going to touch my mouse so that Laura can come back.
Yes, it's just so funny because it's just so when I know it's my turn, I'm like moving my mouse, trying to see if I can unmute myself, and I want to say, Rachel, I'm here, I'm here, but I can't say anything because I'm muted and my mouse is not cooperating. But that's so amazing. Like, I mean, this is the second time I heard you go through that, and it still just kind of blows me away. All of the different ways that you can change task cards and do more with them. So if you have an administrator who thinks that task cards are just fluff, they need to watch this webinar because there's way more to them. So thanks for all those strategies. Okay, let's move on to some other ways. I've got to get back over here on the screen. I'm going to be digging into cooperative learning strategies and games and assessment. So, you know what, before I go into that, let me just take a look at, I saw some questions coming up that I kind of wanted to mention. Let's see. Someone asked, one thing was, someone asked, are these power-up suggestions in the pack with the teacher directions? I'm not exactly clear on that question, but these power-up suggestions are only in this webinar. That's it. Like, there's not a book or something. But when I take this webinar and turn it into it's going to be a product. It will be added to another product. It will be sold separately, and there will be PDF version of the slides that you can have. But that's pretty much the only place. And that's one reason that we provide the notes handout so that you can jot some things down as we're going along. And if we're going too fast, you got the replay coming to you tomorrow, so you can go through that too. Okay, so these are six cooperative learning strategies to boost achievement. I am just a big, huge fan of cooperative learning. I used it pretty much throughout my teaching career and really wouldn't know what to do without it. It really, it's so awesome for getting kids talking, active, thinking, interacting. You know, it's really most cooperative learning strategies, if they are implemented well, will boost achievement. Now, many of you may have had bad experiences with cooperative learning where you felt like it was chaotic or one kid was doing all the work and they just didn't get results. It was very frustrating for you. It may very well come down to management and structure, because if you just tell kids to work together in a group, you are going to have one student just taking over. But the six strategies that I'm sharing with you today are very structured approaches, so that if you follow these directions, and a lot of these are in my free resources and in my products, because it's just the way I taught. So when I started creating resources, I would naturally include these and the directions for how to do them. I think you'll find yourself being more successful when you use a more structured approach. So let me show you exactly what I mean with that. Well, before I go to the first structure, let me just elaborate a little bit more about the importance of talking. I heard this quote a couple of months ago. I'm not really sure where it came from, but it really stuck with me. Whoever is doing the talking is doing the learning. And I saw that over and over in the classroom, that giving the kids a chance to share, discuss, justify. And that's where with the task cards, it could be just a simple activity that kids are doing on their own, but it's going to be more effective if they're working with at least a partner and they're having to justify their answers. Having them do the task cards on their own would be good for assessment, but if you really want to engage kids, partners and teams are great. So I wrote a blog post called Task Card Talk that has a little overview of these six strategies, but honestly, I'm going to give you a lot more detail in the webinar than what I gave in the post, but I just wanted you to be aware of that. So the first strategy is pairs compare. It's really just two kids working and they're going to be comparing what they do, but it's the way I'm going to teach you to do it is very structured so that the kids will be successful. And once they learn these steps, it'll be like natural to them. So materials for each pair. I love dry erase boards in the classroom. I know there's some digital things now like boogie boards and other things, but they need some device where they can write on it and erase it easily. And one set of task cards per pair. And the setup is that you need to assign partners in advance, and it's best to pair kids who have similar ability levels. A lot of times the natural tendency would be to put your strongest student with your weakest student because you figure that person can teach the other child, but that's actually not an effective pairing for either one of them. For one thing, the child that's a strong student, they're not getting challenged in any way, and even if they like teaching others, they're not getting that challenge that they need. But a lot of times the big problem is that they can't connect like that. Really smart kid, they don't really even know how they know the answer. They know how to do it. They have a hard time explaining it. And the low kid can feel like very intimidated by working with the other child. They don't even know what questions to ask. But if you put like a strong student, a gifted student with an average student, those two are close enough that they can, you know, connect and communicate and learn from each other. And even the average student, you know, they're going to have ways that they challenge that top student. And then if you put an average student with a low performing student, they're close enough together that they can connect. So I always assign partners for especially math or language arts or whatever. Like if it's a skill-based area, I would not do random partners. And then you seat the partners together and put the task cards, place them face down between them. So here's the dry erase board variation. Now I'll give you a paper and pencil one in a minute. So one person turns over the top task card and reads it aloud, and both students write the answer on their own boards without talking. So this really pushes the accountability issue. They can't just wait for the other student to tell them, you know, here's how you do the problem. Like, they have to think about it, and they have to try to figure something out. They put their boards face down when finished, and then when they realize they're, you know, they kind of make eye contact, okay, we're both done. They compare and discuss their answers, and they check the answer key if one is available. And then they just repeat the steps for each card. But by doing it in a structured way like this, rather than just having like taking turns, you do a problem, I do a problem, there's a lot of wait time there. This way they're working all the time, and they're comparing and discussing is a very powerful activity. Now, if you don't have dry erase boards or you want a paper and pencil record of the activity, you can use this paper and pencil variation. So both, you're going to have them follow the same steps, but they're going to record their answers on paper instead of the dry erase board. It could be just numbered paper, or you could have, like if there's an answer page that comes with the task cards, like this comes with my time in word form set, and so they could just circle the answer there and compare. I actually came up, this is a free resource I just put together in the last couple of days for you. It's a generic task cards practice recording form. I made one with 24 answers and one with 32. And the good thing about this page is that if the kids are doing task cards that are out of order, they might forget that they have to write down the number of the card on, you know, if they're going to record the answers, and this has it all laid out for them. And this is a little bit higher level, maybe a little more intense, not intense, but like this has a place for them to work out the answer, like if it's a math problem, and put their card number, and then as far as the check mark, you could get them to circle it if they both get it correct. You know, you could use it in a variety of different ways, but that's on the freebie page that we'll give to you at the end. There is a variation called solve and switch, and I'm not going to go into detail because I have this all written out as a freebie, and this is one thing that I do tend to do. I give very thorough directions in my products, so the page in the middle is like some teacher directions, and then I have the student directions that you can print out and laminate and put in a center or whatever. But solve and switch is very similar, but each kid takes a card, and they're different cards, and they solve their own card, the problem on their own card, and then they switch, and then they solve that problem, and then they compare. So it's kind of like a 2x2x2. They're doing two problems at a time, and it has recording pages. So that's a variation of partner work. So Rachel was went into quite a bit of detail about the different types of task cards, and this is a really important piece because with the different types of task cards, when you think about these cooperative learning activities, you've got to pick the right task card for the activity. So for pairs compare, you want short answer or multiple choice, something that they can do pretty quickly because they're both working at the same time. So computations, single step word problems, task cards with one answer. You would not want to use discussion or open-ended response cards or like math problems that are real, like multiple steps, and you know those are going to take them 30 minutes to do. That wouldn't work for pairs compare. Mix freeze pair is a variation on pairs compare that gets the kids up and moving, and it's a great strategy. It's one of my favorites because it's very teacher directed. It's not like the kids are just like running around the room doing stuff and you feel like you're sort of out of control. You are guiding them through the whole thing. So the way it works is this: you say mix and you have your students stand up and walk quietly around the room. And then you say freeze and they have to stop. And then you say pair and they find a partner. Now I'll just interject here in this step before I give you a little bit of management on this. I have the picture of the little boombox there and the instrument, because a fun thing to do is to use like a musical cue or like turn on music when you say mix and then let them mix around the room, and then when you turn off the music, that's their cue. You know, you say freeze, but turning off the music means they stop. And like each time they're mixing around the room, you turn on the music, and it's especially fun if you have like holiday theme music or like beach music at the end of the year, or I don't know, it's just a great way to add in some music. So let's get back to the part about finding a partner. This is I want to give you some extra classroom management on this, because as a former fifth grade teacher, and I taught fifth grade for about 25 years, I'm going to tell you a little bit of insider information about what fifth graders do at first. So you can expect it and be ready for it. So what I saw was kids jumping over chairs to get to their friend across the room, or kids following each other around the room so that they could be somebody's partner. You know, people, kids like kind of turning away and not wanting to be somebody's partner. You know, there's all these little social skill things that go on. So what I would suggest is when you do this activity, you should have a backup plan in mind. You either have, and I wouldn't make it task cards. Task cards are too fun. I would make it a out of the like a textbook, like a page in the textbook, like pick one out that is a review activity from weeks ago that they should be able to do, but it's not a lot of fun. And just keep it in the back of your mind that if they can't handle this activity, then that you're going to just put them into the textbook activity. So for this strategy, when you ask them to find a partner, you have them get that partner and then stand shoulder to shoulder and face you and wait for directions. Those who don't have a partner should raise their hand and move to the front of the room. And then you have to kind of help with the final pairings. But a lot of times when they raise their hand, they start looking around, they see somebody else who has a hand raised, and then they'll start pairing up. And this is trickier the first few times that you do it, and I would suggest you only do like three rounds of it the first time to kind of get them used to it. But some things that happen is sometimes the same kid will be left alone over and over. So I would always tell the kids up front, like when we pair up, the same person can't be left over every time, because if that happens, we're just going to go into the textbook. I just tell them up front, like we can't have that. And I don't really wait till it happens. I just tell them ahead of time that can't happen. So I'm trying to think if there's anything else. But anyways, after they learn how to do this, then it's a great way to get them up and moving. But you really have to teach it at first. So once they're paired with a partner, this is where the task cards come in. You show them a task card with a question or a problem. And I will share some ways to do that at the end of the webinar in the assessment piece, but one that comes to mind is to use a document camera and put the task card under the document camera. Or if you have an image of it, a digital image, you could project it onto the screen. And you kind of guide them, like, talk over this question or solve the problem. If they're solving a problem, they might need to bring a dry erase board with them and each work it out on their own, and then compare answers or whatever so you can combine it with other structures. Then you call on a few students to share their responses with the class. It's also good to ask them, like, what did your partner say about this, if it's a discussion question, to see if they're listening to each other. And then they, you know, you say mix and turn on the music, pair, freeze, and they make sure that you have the rule that every time they pair up, they have to have a new partner. So I would only do this like maybe 3 or 4 times, and then, you know, that was like enough, and it was time to go back to our seats and do something else. So this is a free set of directions that's on the freebie page for you that has it all summarized nicely. Okay, I know I spent a lot of time on those first two. The rest of them go a lot quicker, but I wanted to give you some detail there. Okay, so let's look at the task card types for mix, freeze, pair. If you notice, this has short answer and multiple choice, but it also has discussion, because you can do discussion cards. When you pair them up, you can give them a discussion question to talk over. It's guided by the teacher. That works well. So getting to know you questions, math review, single step word problems, literature discussion questions, and so on. Like in the middle of the screen, there's a fraction task card that's from my comparing fraction set that says, what's wrong with the fraction bar, these fraction bar comparisons? One of my key points in the fraction unit that I have is, like, kids need to know how to draw and how to represent fractions properly. And as you can see, the two-thirds bar is not divided in equal parts. So they would, you would put it up there and they would talk about that. So they're discussing it, and then they tell you, you know, which one is wrong, and you call on students. Rachel has a set for place value that would be really good. It says, which statement is not true about this number? So if you had that projected on the screen, they could go through and talk with their partner. Is A true? Is B true? Is C true? It really makes them slow down. Like, if they're doing it on their own, they're just going to slap an answer down, A or C or whatever. But if they're doing it with a partner and you tell them to go through and talk about each one, it's they're way more thoughtful about that. Showdown is a structure that many of you are familiar with. In fact, let me just stop for a second. And is anybody familiar with Showdown? I'll just wait for a second if you want to type in the box. So I saw that somebody mentioned Kagan. So, So I should go ahead and tell you that I was trained in Kagan years ago. The strategies that I'm sharing, some of them I've picked up from Kagan. Some of them, like Showdown, I actually invented Showdown when I was writing one of the cooperative learning books for Kagan. And I came up with this activity when I was writing my decimals book, Discovering Decimals. And I didn't think it was a structure that they had, so I called Spencer Kagan and I asked him, you know, and I explained what I was doing. And he was like, no, that is that we don't have that. That is not a structure, so I think it's a new one. And he came up with the name Showdown for it. So I think you'll enjoy this. And I have blog articles about it and everything, but I'll go through it quickly. But it's really neat because it seems like a game, but it's a great review activity. So Kagan. These are all Kagan-like, you know, just the structure aspect is what I think I learned and picked up. Kagan resources are awesome. So I'm trying to click, and I'm not going anywhere here. Oh, I know what it is. When I click over to the presenter panel, I have to click on the screen. It can be a little tricky. All right, so you see I'm a fan of dry erase boards. So they all have dry erase boards, markers, and erasers, one set of task cards per team. So you put the task cards in the center of the team, face down, and you just name, like, person number one, you're the leader. So you designate someone on each team to be the first leader, person number three. And the first leader turns over the first task card. They read it aloud. Maybe they put it in the middle of the team. Without talking, the students solve the problem or answer the question on their own dry erase boards. And when finished, everyone places their dry erase boards face down in front of them. You see, this is a lot like that pairs compare, but you're doing it in a whole team. And the next step is the leader says showdown, and everyone shows their work. They compare, they discuss, they justify their answers. The leader checks the answer key, and if anyone was wrong, the team members continue to, like, kind of discuss it and clarify it and make sure that they understand what's wrong with it. Then the role of leader rotates clockwise, and it continues on, and, you know, you repeat the steps with the remaining task cards. So this was just an absolute staple in my classroom for review activities. It was great for math and for other types of review. it seems like a game, but if you notice, it's not competitive because there's no points or anything. So it kind of takes the pressure aspect off of the whole, cooperative versus competitive. So the appropriate cards for showdown would be the same thing as the pairs compare, short answer, multiple choice, and you would not want to use discussion or open-ended or anything that's like really time-consuming, like complex math word problems or something, because, it needs to be like a quick review. Oh, and back to the page, the round and compare cards, that is actually a free thing on one of my pages on my website. I didn't think to put it on the freebies page, but these are task cards too. This is kind of the old-fashioned kind that I started out with years ago, where I just had a bunch of problems on a page, and I would print one copy for each team, and I would just get them to cut them apart before the activity started. So I actually have a lot of those types of things scattered throughout my website as just single-page freebies. Team Scoot is a variation on the traditional Scoot. Let me look in the question box, chat box, I call it. How many people are familiar with the class Scoot game, where you have a set of task cards, you put one on each student's desk, and then the kids scoot around the room answering the questions on the cards? Okay. So it looks like a lot of people are saying yes. If somebody doesn't know, they should put no in there, because I'm going on the assumption that you guys know the class one. Well, I learned about Scoot after I left the classroom just a few years ago, and I thought it would be a great way for assessment, but as far as a review activity, I guess with my cooperative learning background, it kind of concerned me that there wasn't an opportunity for the kids to talk and discuss their answers and get help from each other and all of that. So I came up with the idea of Team Scoot, and it's like the whole class version, except let me go ahead and put the directions up there so you can just be reading them. This time, after you put the cards on the desk, the students scoot around a team of four, not the whole class. And so they're quietly going around, and you're saying scoot, scoot. But when they get back to their team, the fourth step, that's when they actually talk over what their answers are and discuss it and get help and explain how they solve the problem and everything. So it's much easier. Then what they do is, after everybody's done that, then you have them, like, you can either move the cards to, give them a new set of cards, or you can actually have the kids get up and move to a new set of desks. So they wouldn't necessarily get through all the cards, but they would really deepen their understanding of the ones that they did. And I have directions for this. It's another freebie. It is on that page. It has like full directions for you as a teacher, and then it has directions you could project for the class. And it's a great strategy to get kids engaged. So the class Scoot I would keep for assessment purposes. Okay, so you need quick things. It's like pairs compare. You don't want to do discussion questions or open-ended. You want single step things, vocabulary review, short answer, multiple choice. None of those were good for discussion. Well, mixed freeze pair was. But the last two I'm going to share with you are great discussion strategies. And this is just a picture of one of my classes from a few years back doing literature circles. And I just put it there for discussion purposes. But the way this works, it's a structured type of discussion, very simple. Ask students to number off around the team. Give a stack of discussion task cards to number one. Number one turns over the top card and reads it aloud. And then the person next around the team, two, is given the first opportunity to respond, to answer, to share some type of response to that prompt. And then student number three gets to share next. They can add a detail. They can clarify a point. They might disagree with the answer. They might cite a text reference, or they might not have anything to add, and they might say they want to pass. And then you keep going around the team. So student number four, and then go back to the person who started. They all get a chance if they want to add anything to the discussion. And then after that discussion ends, the leader passes the deck of cards to student two, who flips over the top card, becomes the next question reader, and it goes on that way. So a little accountability strategy to make sure that the kids are actually listening to the discussion is let the kids discuss the cards, and then you randomly choose a card for them to respond to in writing, or you select a card, or let them randomly choose a card. And Rachel will be telling you about some random strategies later in the presentation. But this is a very structured way of having a discussion. But a lot of kids that have trouble getting along with each other, this is where they need to start, because if you just give them, you say talk this over, it's just a free-for-all and one kid does all the talking. So, excuse me. So the task cards for those would be discussion or open-ended questions. So Rachel has a set called Thinkables that would be great. End of the year, she has these end of the year task cards, as she mentioned, were free. I have some Common Core questions for every grade level, kindergarten through fifth grade. Each set has a personal response questions. It has informational text, and it has literature, and they're actually tied directly to the standards. I went and looked at the standards to come up with those questions, and I tried to put it in kid-friendly terms. You might have the card there, number two, that's more generic. And you would not want multiple choice or short answers since it's a discussion. And then the last strategy, I bet you a lot of you are familiar with it because it is actually in quite a few of my different freebies and products, and I have this on my blog. But this is a good way to equalize participation in a discussion without making them go around the team. Sometimes going around the team is challenging because they want to say something when it comes to mind. They don't necessarily want to say it when it's their turn. So the way this goes is you use craft sticks to monitor the participation. Each student starts with three craft sticks, and the leader has a set of task cards. They turn over the top card, read it aloud, and then if a student wants to answer that question, they hold up a stick. And of course, you have to teach the kids, you don't wave it around, you just kind of hold it up politely, and then the leader holds that cup and kind of reaches it out towards a student to choose them. The student drops the stick in the cup and answers the question and maybe talks for 30, 45 seconds. And then if anybody else wants to talk about that particular card, they hold up a stick and so on. And then when that card, they finish discussing that card, it gets passed to the next leader who flips over a card. But the neat thing about this one is when the kids run out of their three sticks, they have to sit there and listen until all team members have used their sticks too. And this is a really great lesson for those kids that want to dominate the discussion all the time. Because the first time they do it, they're going to go through all three sticks, and then they have to sit and wait and wait and wait. And then they hear great questions that they wish they could have answered, but they were so quick to jump in and answer the first few questions that they're out of sticks. And then the student that's shy gets stuck with three sticks at the end with everybody looking at them, and they learn they don't like that either. So it causes them to start participating, way more equally. And what I found was the kids love it so much that if you forget to get out the talking sticks, let's say you're in social studies and you say, okay, put your heads together and talk over this question, or if you're in literature circles or book discussions or whatever, kids will come up and say, where are those talking sticks? We need the talking sticks. And that means, somebody's probably taking over the conversation. So I used to just keep the sticks in cups and kept them over on a shelf off to the side. And if a team needed to go get them, they could go get them. So same kind of thing with the talking sticks task cards. You want those discussion questions, open-ended, literature circles, book versus movie discussions, journal prompts, all those kinds of things, but not multiple choice. So I use this thing so much, and it was so essential. This was a picture from years ago of the kids using talking sticks, and that I ended up making it into a product, so it would have the full directions. So this Talking Sticks discussion pack has the directions for the kids and for you, and it has, I think there's about 12 different sets of task cards. They're very plain, they're just discussion cards, but literature, nonfiction, and then I have an editable set of discussion cards that you can just type your own questions, right on the cards. that was a big, huge piece on cooperative learning, but I think it was an important piece, and the rest of the webinar will move along a little quicker, but I know that cooperative learning can be a real challenge, and I love to share management strategies with you. So we're going to go into tips for using task cards with games next. So let's jump into that, because we want games to be fun and effective. So just a couple of pointers to maximize learning. You want to give those clear and specific directions. You can use teacher-created or commercial games, and then just add task cards and modify the directions. And it's really important, just like with cooperative learning, to learn to choose the right type of task card and answer key for the activity. So when I say give clear and specific game directions, if you're going to make up a game with based on a commercial game or make up your own game, you have to think about some of these factors. Are the kids going to take turns, or do they both answer every card? So if it's real short answers, maybe they can take turns, but as you've seen with Pairs Compare, my preference is to have both kids answer every card, and then if whoever gets it right, they can spin the spinner or roll the dice or whatever the thing they're supposed to do is in the directions. But I like it for both kids to answer every card so nobody's sitting around and waiting. Then you need to let the kids know, well, what happens if they get the problem correct and get to go? They get to spin, whatever, but what if they don't? And what if they get help with it, or can they get help with it? And at what point can they help each other? And is it okay to talk? And I'm hoping it would be okay to talk, but you may say you have to wait until you solve the problem and then check the answers, and then you can only talk to explain or ask questions at that point. So just be very, to get the most out of task card games, really think through the learning process there and, you know, make it work for you. And this is a game, Bingo Showdown, that I came up with a couple of years ago, and I'm going to show you how to play this. It's a combination of regular bingo and showdown, and it can be played in groups like this. I will give you a little warning, playing it in small groups, they get a little bit excited about it. They love it, so it's really probably better as a whole group activity in most cases. So you can review any content area. And you will need bingo boards, but they need to be numbered 1 to 24, not those, because those have all numbers all over the place. You need those bingo chips and markers. You're going to need, so there's a generic bingo board that you could use. You need 24 task cards that are numbered. And for some reason, there it goes, takes a moment. So there's a whole stack of task cards that are numbered, 1 to 24, and then you need dry erase boards, markers, you know, erasers. So this is what you need for Bingo Showdown. So here's how it works. First, you decide who'll be the first leader. I would start with just doing it as the teacher is the leader, play it against the class quite a few times before you let them do that on their own. The leader selects the first task card, announces the number, the card number, and reads the question aloud, or as a teacher, you would display it on the, you know, with a projector or whatever. Then you follow those basic showdown rules where everybody works out the problem, they put their board face down, then you as the teacher say showdown, and then they show their answers, and then anyone who gets the correct answer gets to cover up that task card number. So after a while it's going to look like this, and then of course regular rules, first with 5 in a row wins the game, and then if you're doing it in a small group, the leader role rotates to the left. You know, if it's a teacher, you could call a student or let the winner of one bingo game come up and be the leader for the next round. So it really helps you get the most out of bingo, and what I love about this is you can use any set of task cards at all, as long as you have a set that's numbered 1 to 24. And I'm sure you can figure out that if you have a set that has 32 in it, then just take out 25 through 32 and set them aside and use 1 through 24. So I actually just ended up, this is a product that has been in the works for a long time, and it's almost ready on the webinar. Putting the final touches on the webinar really kind of got in the way with me finishing up, but this is going to be ready tomorrow. I mean, I'm that close to it. But I made up a generic version of it so that you would have directions that you could use with your kids. There's black and white and color of it. I have 30 game boards that are on half sheets of paper, so it does save paper. You can laminate them and just use them over and over all year long. And then for the, I have small group and large group directions. And for the small group directions, I made like a little card that the kids can fold, and whoever's the leader, they can put that in front of them. So it kind of helps monitor who's the leader for each round. So this is part of a new set of resources I created, started a few months ago, called Just Add Task Cards. And it's games that have generic directions. You can add any task card you want. And then the great thing is, once the kids learn the rules of the game, you can keep that same game in a center and just switch out your task cards, you know, every week, put new task cards in. Another one that I turned into a generic game is Monster Math Mix-Up. This was in a couple of my different products, and it's a fun little game because what happens is four kids play together, or it could be two, or it could be three, and each kid has a separate monster puzzle that's cut into 10 pieces. And they have to solve the problem on the task card on their dry erase board, and then if they get it right, they spin the spinner. And if you see on the spinner, it has things like add two pieces, add one, remove a piece. And so they follow the directions, and the student who has the gets their monster put together first is the winner. But you can, I did this, I actually put this in two different products, and then I kind of got smart and I said, wait a minute, I don't need to make a whole product for this. If I just had the game directions, then people could use their existing task cards and just have the game and the generic directions. So for example, I have a set of bingo cards for order of operations. I thought you could just pull out the order of operations task cards if you had that product, and then you could use it with the monster mix-up game. So I did end up putting together monster mix-up as a separate game. Generic directions, everything's in black and white and color. And then I did, some people like to get their kids to color the monsters, and it saves on color ink, so I put those black line versions of it. So I've got like four games maybe in that pack that are generic that you could just run them off, laminate them. This is a great time of year to do that kind of thing, and then you would have them all year. And then Rachel, it's your turn, so I'm going to see if I can get you to you might still, you actually still do have the mouse control because I never took it back. You've been good. Yeah, because you must not have touched your mouse or your keyboard, and that's awesome because I would have had problems if you had. But anyways, I will mute myself for the moment because I believe after this you're going into the lightning round anyways, right? So
that is right.
I will just step back and you can take over.
All right. Well, thank you, Laura. I'm always amazed when I hear about cooperative games. I love them, and I really love that bingo one. So wish I'd had that when I was teaching, because I had a class that just went bonkers for bingo, and I was always looking for ways to use it, and I had never used it like that. But you can't go back in time. All right. We're going to talk about commercial games. At least I hope we are, if I can get this to move. Ah, there we are. Okay. We're going to go back one. All right, so first of all, this is when you're using your store-bought games, things like, Connect 4. We'll talk about that in a minute. Games that you buy at the store, or better yet, the garage sale, or maybe that students donate, or maybe old games that you've had. There's some really great way to power up those games and make them learning games. The first thing you want is short games and simple games. You don't want their brain power to be used in the game. You want it to be used in the task cards. So stay away from Life and Monopoly, and those are not good. You want games that are more like Connect 4. It's over really soon, right? And you don't have to think too much. Checkers, Chinese checkers. Trouble is a great one. Kids just love that Pop-O-Matic. Pickup sticks. I love pickup sticks with task cards because they're just so tactile. Don't break the ice. Those types of games are great with task cards, and you can so find those at garage sales. So the basic gist, and Laura went over this before, basically the kids earn their turns by answering task cards correctly. And you can have them go one at a time. You know, this is my turn. I draw my task card. Maybe the person to the right reads it to me. Or you can have you can do one task card with the leader. Everybody writes it on their whiteboards or their papers or whatever, and then they all show them, and then you check them against the answer key, and And then everybody who got it right gets to have a turn, roll the dice, pick the card, whatever it is. And those who, kids who didn't, unfortunately, get skipped. So, should be turning in a minute. All right, so you want to be sure and choose the right task cards for this. You want short answer style. You can use multiple choice, but if you use multiple choice, you want ones with short answers. You don't want ones with like sentence answers or complicated answers, because then kids are, if you have somebody reading the task card, they're constantly going to be saying, what was B again? Can you read the choices again? So short answer style is nice. A time when, so here's some examples, but like with this one, a short answer, multiple choice makes sense because there's only two choices. And in this one, these are fantasy realism cards. The two choices are always the same for every card. It's either going to be fantasy or realism. So, or like with fact and opinion, it's either going to be fact or opinion. So those are times a multiple choice would work pretty well. You want questions that can be answered quickly. We do not want multi-step word problems here. We don't want ones that take a lot of thought. And, of course, only one correct answer. We don't want to go multiple choice with that. When you're doing this, you need to think about how kids are going to check their answers. So one option is you could take the answer key and you could laminate it. With this one, since I didn't put you would probably want the game at the name of the task cards at the top. You could also write them on the back. So this would be a great answer key to have. You can write the answers on the backs of the cards and then just train the kids to not reveal the back until it's time to check the answer. QR codes are great because you can't see the answer until you're ready to see the answer. So I think that's a really good option. And also, if you're doing math, once again, you could use calculators. And so this is an example of the answer being on the back. And here's your calculators and QR codes. So what we're going to do right now, I think, if it will switch, is, yes, we're going to do the lightning round. So these are 10 more ideas that you can use, and they're pretty easy to set up. And we're going to go through these fairly quickly as well. So the first one is a scavenger hunt. Somebody already mentioned this in the Q&R that somebody likes to do this. So what you're going to do is you are going to hide cards around your classroom, under chairs, on the inside doors of cabinets, wherever, you know, you think a good hiding place is. Even in plain sight, if you just sort of, you know, put it, tuck it in a corner somewhere, kids take their answer sheets on task cards. They wander around the classroom, and they eventually fill them all in. And that's a really fun, motivating activity. You can do it outside. Another thing you could do with this is you could take a set of task cards, and you could hide them on Monday. And then you don't have a set time for the activity. It's just that during the week, kids do it when they have time. Maybe it's indoor recess. Maybe they're a fast finisher. They finished a little early. They arrive at school a little early, whatever it is. And by the end of the week, you know, they're trying to get the whole answer sheet filled out. Morning work. So this is such a shortcut. This is a total shortcut. If you're having one of these mornings, this is the thing to do. So you don't even have to cut the task cards apart. This is a set of measurement task cards. And here's the page with four of them, not even cut apart. You stick this on your document camera. You have your kids take their paper and fold it in fourths, or else you have a whiteboard. They have whiteboards, and they're drawing lines to divide it in four like this. You display it on the document counter. The kids label each quadrant with the card number. And then if you've got a story problem, they have a great place here to show their work. Or if it's a few sentences long, or if they need to draw a picture, then you've got this great section, and then you can correct them. So easy, right? So that's a nice, easy way to use task cards. Interactive notebooks. This idea came from Anna in Simply Skilled of Second. I thought this was brilliant. She sticks the task cards onto regular paper. She does not laminate them. It looks like she also does things with the printer to reduce them. And there's actually she has a blog post on this, which is in your resources at the end of that you'll be getting, so you can look at how she does this. So you basically print the cards on regular paper. You use the border as a tab to glue it into your interactive notebook, and then students can write, as you can see this student here in the upper right, and down here in the lower left, you can see they've written on the back of the card and also on underneath the card. So that's a great way to use task cards in interactive notebooks. Random selection. Kids love it when you make it random. I don't know why. I think everybody likes a little bit of randomness. So one idea is you can print them on regular paper and put them in prize shells here, or in Easter eggs, or I knew one teacher who rolls them up into cute little scrolls, and then she ties each one with a little piece of yarn or a ribbon, puts them all in a basket, and the kids draw them out randomly. Another idea is that you could go fishing for task cards. If you put a paperclip on each of your task cards, and then you make the fishing pole, right? You've got your dowel, you have your string, you have your magnet, and kids just fish them, and they get to, when they fish out a task card, they can play with friends, and if they answer it correctly, they get to keep their task card, and of course, if they get it wrong, they have to throw it back to the pond of task cards. Kids love fishing, especially the younger ones. Face down on a whiteboard. You could do this with regular task cards during an activity, maybe during like a, if you were playing some kind of like a class game that mimicked a game show. But here's what I like to do with brain breaks. These are the brain breaks for the day. The ones up at the top with the little, these are little ducks, you can't tell. But anyway, so say you need 4 brain breaks in a day. You pick them out ahead of time, and as you need a brain break, you let a student say, well, I'd like to do number 3. Say, and so then you turn over number 3, you all do the brain breaks, and that's great. But then at the end of the day, you leave a few extra minutes because this is your bonus brain break. This is one you know they love, and they have to earn this puppy. And if they've had a good day and they've met the standards that you've set for them, they've been polite, whatever it is, then you say, good job, and you flip over that card and you get to do the brain break. But let's say that they have not had a good day. It has been a dreadful day, and you do not want to reward them with anything. Well, now you've got a couple minutes at the end of the day to discuss it. What went wrong? Why didn't we get our bonus brain break? And what can we do tomorrow to make it better, to earn that bonus brain break? Because you're going to leave it up here for tomorrow. So that's just kind of a fun way to use randomness. The next one, task card checkout. This is a great picture of somebody preparing task cards for checkout. You can use folders like she did, but you could also use baggies. And then you take the folders and or the baggies and you put them all in a bin, and kids can take them back to their seats and work on independently during independent work time. Or you could send it home for homework. And I think this is a great thing to do with a student who is really struggling, because now they can work on it in as slow as they need to be, right? They can work at it at home. They can take their time. Maybe mom and dad can help, big brother. And they don't have to do the remediation out in the hall or in front of other students where everybody knows that this kid needs extra time. You can use it. Another thing you might want to do if you're doing independent task cards is have some kind of a reward tier for completing a given number. They get a little prize when they've completed a different number, maybe something like, you know, extra recess or getting to sit with a friend or whatever rewards you like to use. I think that Denise Boehm of I can't remember the name of her store. Sunny Days in Second Grade. Yes, Sunny Days in Second Grade. I think she uses a brain bead section system, and you can find that on her blog. And it's great for kids, as we said, who need extra practice. Put your task cards in odd places. Now, you can use, like, test prep regular task cards, but I think it's fun to use creative and critical thinking skills, to use those higher-level thinking skills like this one. You're joining the 3 words with 1 word, or this is an odd one out and it actually has several answers and the students have to justify it. So how about where they line up? Kids are lining up. They're waiting to come in or to go out. They're not doing much. They may as well be staring at the wall, coming up with using their brains. How about on the back of a bathroom pass, or if you have a bathroom that you don't share with many classrooms, on the back of a stall door? Because, you know, they're just sitting there. They might as well do something. By the door, leave them by the door. So you're heading off to music or art, and it might be that you're going to have to stand in the hall for a few minutes while the teacher finishes up with the last class. You can do some would you rather questions or some fun prompts, or just keep them in the front of your classroom anytime you have a few extra minutes. Fast finisher station is a great one. And this is, I think that fast finisher stations, they're great if they're writing prompts or something a little bit more challenging. These name number task cards are actually quite challenging. This is a free set of Fall Fun for Fast Finishers is actually the full name. And these are pretty writing based. And so here you've got a student working. So set up that task. Let's actually do it this way. So make a table at the back of the classrooms where fast finishers can go. And rotate sets each week, and again, prompt or higher level thinking is great. The next one is, I think I know what it is, but it's not coming. All right, thought I clicked it. Oh, there we go. All right. It's great to use task cards with a parent volunteer for remedial work. They can work on one-on-one. Just make sure that you've looked at the type of task card to and kind of prep your parent on it and how she should use it with the student. Student-created task cards, these are really a fun thing to do. I like to use them with literature. So you've read a book together as a class, and now you're going to provide your kids with index cards and colorful pens and pencils, and every student is going to make a task card, and now and then you're all going to do them. It's very empowering for students because every kid in the class is going to do their one task card to make the set. Another thing you could do is make it into a culminating project for a book, so or a unit. Maybe you've studied pioneers, and the project is to make your own set of task cards with your answer key. And then you're going to trade your set with, students are going to trade their sets and do each other's sets. Again, very empowering and a great way for students to show their knowledge. If you have younger students who maybe aren't ready whose writing might be hard to read, you could probably set this up on the computer where they have something that they fill out. You can play Boom. This is a free game. It's very simple. You have these Boom cards, and it's free. You mix the Boom cards in with your task cards. This is a set of antonym task cards, which are also free. So you mix the Boom cards. I can't remember how many are in the set, maybe five or six. You mix them in there. Students draw the card at the top of the pile, and they answer the question. And if they answer it right, the student gets to keep the card. But if they draw a Boom card, they've got to put all their cards back in the discard. Or if that's too harsh, maybe just one or two cards. And, of course, the student at the end of the game who has the most cards is the winner. So those are 10 ideas for you to use. And I'm going to turn it back over to Laura, who has some awesome things to talk about with assessment.
Wow. I'm just amazed listening to those 10 ideas. They came so quick, but they're so great. I know that they sparked a lot of thoughts in everybody who has task cards about all the ways they could be using them. Now, we decided to wrap up, basically. This is kind of the last big piece with assessment. And I really wanted to focus on something that is, I don't know, I think that it made a drastic difference in my teaching when I learned about formative assessment and how to use it to adjust instruction. So when you're teaching interactively with your class, and this whole webinar series is about interactive teaching, the Plickers webinar is part of that, and I did one on building math vocabulary. You know, the whole kind of theme of everything is being interactive, and that means not just teaching like a whole class period and then checking at the end of the class period to find out what they learned. It means breaking up your instruction into little chunks, being interactive, and kind of having ways of doing quick checks along the way. You assess knowledge and skills regularly, and then you keep adjusting your instruction. I actually went pretty deep into this in one of the Plickers webinars, because Plickers is amazing for formative assessment. But let me move on with some strategies for formative assessment. So I always have to remember I got to click back down here on the presentation screen. Here we go. So assessing with task cards is super easy. The strategies I'm going to share with you in the next few minutes are really designed for group assessment, like the whole group at once or small guided groups. It's not really for independent assessment. You can use task cards for that, like have the kids, you know, go to a center and complete them there. But this is the more like a quick assessment with the whole group. So it's an easy way to check for understanding. With this type of assessment, everybody's responding to the same task cards. So after you teach a lesson, you may put up, like, you know, five math problems one at a time, and the kids number dry erase boards. This is actually one that was done in my class, and then they answer the questions, and then I would have the kids just stack the dry erase boards on the counter, and I would try to check them throughout, you know, the next 15 minutes or whatever. Sometimes I would do this before we had a bathroom break, and then I would kind of check them during that time. And when I recorded a grade or took a grade, I would record it, but it was only for my planning, and it was to see, like, does this student need homework? Do they need extra practice? it wasn't really recorded in the grade book as an actual grade that counted toward their grade average for the semester. But it was incredibly helpful for me as a teacher because it let me know how many of my students understand the concept. Do I need to do more work with this tomorrow? Or, you know, or if you do this in the middle of class and you do a few task cards, then you know, okay, they got it. Now I need to move on. And Plickers is a super easy way to, I mean, like, kids can respond. They can still work it out on the dry erase board, but then you can quickly scan the whole class and just like sweeping your iPhone around the class and you just capture it all. Now, if you want to display the physical task cards, the document camera is, I think, something that a lot of teachers are doing now. In one of the groups that I have the upper elementary Facebook group, I asked the group, like, how do you display your task cards when you're using them for, you know, whole group activities, and one teacher said she uses a poster maker. She makes giant task cards out of them, and I thought that was a pretty neat idea. I don't imagine she does it for all of her cards, but just maybe some particular ones she wants to use for digging in deeper. And then one teacher said that she has something called a hue that she got from Amazon. I think she might have said she got Donors Choose, you know, got it purchased through Donors Choose, but it's like a very basic document camera, but it's only $50. Like, I was so impressed with that, and they're all different colors, like pink and orange, and I put a link to that on the freebies and resources page for you if you're interested in checking that out, because, you know, to me, I mean, just, you, a document camera, I don't even know how I could teach without a document camera. It's so useful for demonstrating things. Now, another way to display task cards is to convert the task cards to images. So you can do screen captures of them, or there's different methods. I actually have a little tutorial that's called Plickers Made Easy, where I show you how to make images out of your task cards. And then after you have them, you can project them onto a screen. Some teachers say they put them into PowerPoint presentations so they can show them large to the class, maybe if they don't have a document camera. You can upload the images to Plickers or Kahoot, or I heard a Nearpod you could do this with. Like, there's all these apps and online programs that you can upload these task card images to and use them. And I did see a comment when I was asking you earlier about Plickers, and somebody said that their kids like Kahoot a lot better. And now, I have not used Kahoot, but when I started kind of digging in and learning about it, from what I picked up, it seems like Kahoot is very game-like, so it's more fun in that way, that it's like a game, but it sounds like there's some pressure there with the time constraints and points and things. What I like about Plickers for formative assessment is you can quickly assess what the kids know. It's not necessarily like switching into a game kind of environment. I think Kahoot sounds like it'd be great for a lot of situations. But based on what I, you know, in some of the discussion groups, sounds like Plickers would be a better choice if it's purely about assessment. And you could also display them on tablets as images or in mobile device apps. You know, I just started, the more I started thinking about like what you could do with images, I thought, well, instead of printing off those task cards, you could store the images in a folder, like in a Dropbox folder or in some kind of an app. And then the kids could use those like for team showdown. They could just like prop an iPad up in the middle of the team. And instead of flipping the card, a kid could like touch the screen and flip to the next card. I mean, I think there's so many digital ways to use these, you know, task card images, that it soon we won't even feel like we need to print them, I guess. And Rachel, I don't know if you wanted to say something now. You're probably muted, but if you wanted to mention the thing that is going on with you, the little bit of news, or if you want to wait till the end and mention that. But Rachel kind of has a little bit of something that she can share with you either now or at the end. Yeah, you can just tell about it. I don't know that it would be for formative assessment, because I'm not sure if it's something where the teacher can assign all the kids the same. They can. So it could be used for formative. So tell them about it, and then so it does kind of fit in here too then.
So this is something that I'm working on with some friends who have an app company, and they have developed a platform to have task cards in app format that will run across devices, iPads, iPhones, Chromebooks, whatever you've got, so that you can use task cards in the classroom. And right now, a group of beta task card creators, people you know, are making these things and testing them out on their own classrooms, and we are going to open it up to people to check out the freebies and purchase in the summer. So you'll be able to look at those in the summer, and the great thing about they run on your device, so students use them, they get immediate input, it has a game feel, and then there's a lot of reporting tools for teachers so that you'll know you can assign whatever decks you want to whatever students you want, and then you will get reports on how well your students did and how long they took and all kinds of great reporting things. And it's going to be, it's very, the cards that people are creating are very colorful and bright with lots of clip art because they don't have to be printed. So it's a really exciting thing that's coming down the pike, and you will be hearing about it soon. There is information on my blog about it on the front page. You can sign up to keep informed. So that's just
okay,
something to let
great.
You know about.
I wanted to kind of let you share that little bit of exciting news. But in the meantime, I guess you have to, if you want to use the digital method, you need to just make some screen captures, and then there's some options there for displaying task card images. And I did want to mention, too, someone had a comment in the chat that made it sound to me like maybe they thought Plickers was cost money, but Plickers is free. I believe Kahoot is free. There's a lot of these free apps. So I shared with you about how you can do this assessment, but when could you do it would be the final piece. So great times to assess, to use formative assessment, would be before introducing a new concept or a skill, because you can waste a lot of time teaching something that maybe your students already know, or maybe, like I switched from fifth grade to fourth grade for a couple of years to do some looping, and I really overestimated what the kids could do, like in fractions. I thought they could do things that they couldn't do. It would taught a whole lesson. You know, that was back before I really knew about formative assessment, and I should have been assessing them constantly to see if they really had the foundation for what I was teaching. I waited, I taught the lesson, they all, you know, most of them were not successful in the test. Then the next day I had to back up and I wasted a whole day. So before you introduce a new concept, find a couple of task cards or a task card set and pull some of those out and do some quick formative assessment. You can stop during the whole group lesson. So maybe you're teach four or five problems of maybe you're teaching division, then throw a few task cards up there and do a quick check. So you could do it after a whole group lesson, but before you assign independent practice or before you assign homework, because, you know, there's no reason to assign homework if the kids absolutely cannot even begin to do the task. They've got to be able to do it, you know, maybe with like 60% accuracy or 80%, or they're just going to go home and practice it the wrong way. So this is where formative assessment can come in. At the end of class, as an exit ticket that you can have them write on paper and collect it and kind of help you plan the next day's lesson. And then probably one of the most important things to me is to use it right after a cooperative learning activity or a game, but before you assign independent work or homework. Because when you look at these kids working together, you really don't know who understands a concept and how much helping has been going on. So you wouldn't want to just assume that they all understand the skill. You really need to do a little bit of formative assessment at the end of class, and then you can make note of like, okay, these kids are going to need some small group with me, work with me tomorrow, whatever, because they're not quite getting it. So anyways, that brings us to the end of the presentation. I mean, we are going to share the talk about the giveaway and the freebie page. And for those of you who join us a little later, you're not too late, because we're going to give you all that information. But in the meantime, we would like you to give us a little bit of feedback here. What do you love about task cards? And if you've never used them, then I guess it would be what do you love about what you've seen? And what's a strategy you learned today that you can't wait to go back and try? Maybe something new that you hadn't heard of. So I'm going to give just a second, and I'm just going to sort of scroll through. I'm also looking for questions and things that maybe Rachel and I haven't covered that we can cover in the question and answer section. Okay, so all right, it looks like a lot of great ideas coming in. The showdown and the challenge cards that Rachel shared about and Team Scoot. Since a lot of you already knew about Scoot, it was probably pretty easy for you to kind of grasp the idea. And I see people like the flexibility of task cards, talking sticks. Awesome. Well, Rachel and I, at the after the webinar's over, we are able to like download a report about this, and then we look through it and kind of pick up some ideas and make sure that we're doing what we need to do to meet your needs. So we ask before, while we were putting together the webinar, we ask in the We Love Task Cards Facebook group, what do you love about task cards? And these are some ideas that the teachers gave us. Fun way to review. Remember we talked about that boring test prep. They're low prep. Once you prepare them, print them, laminate them, and get them ready, or if the digital ones are not hard. And by the way, this is a good time of year to get task cards for next year and prepare them at the end of the year or over the summer. But once you've got them, they're there. They're low prep. They do help kids focus because they're just looking at that one card and not a whole worksheet. They are easy to help you differentiate, as Rachel shared. They're very versatile. They save you a lot of time. You can use them with any group size, individuals, big group, small group. They do save paper. They're very motivating for kids. They do offer opportunities for quick and easy formative assessment. And most of all, they kept saying over and over how much their kids love task cards. Just bringing out the task cards makes it seem like a game. So this has been a long session. I'll tell you, Rachel, we did pretty good here. We shaved a little time off of the presentation, and I think we hit all of the key points here. I did want to mention to you that I'm doing a summer conference in Virginia Beach, July 28th and 29th. If anybody's interested in information, that'll be on the resources page. We're doing a math. This is a colleague of mine, Pat Calfee, and I. Have taught many workshops together, and we're doing these two sessions. I'll be doing the math toolkit, and Pat will be doing the literacy toolkit, so maybe we'll see some of you there. And it's time for the giveaway. So we are excited to be giving away these two bundles of task cards, and then also after the webinar is processed and I'm able to like convert it and make the PDFs and everything, that will go in the giveaway package as well. And I did want to mention there is one other little bonus giveaway that's going on, and it's described on the freebie page, but if you're on Facebook, when you get to that page, it'll tell you if you go over to my Teaching Resources Facebook page, I've just posted something saying thank you for attending the webinar. And if you find that post and then just comment on it, like some of the things that you just wrote in the question box, you can copy and paste it over there on Facebook and tell us why, what you liked about the session. And then there's going to be a little giveaway for $10 worth of products from my store, Winner's Choice. And that would be a different winner than the bundle winner. Okay, so let me tell you about my bundle. I put together this special bundle. Actually, just went on my store last week, and I will say that the bingo showdown, I will do everything in my power to get that in there by tomorrow. So it's kind of a growing bundle that's not actually in there yet. But what is in the bundle is a variety of things, including the talking sticks that I showed you and different types of task cards. And then all of these things would sell for about $30. Some of this would be a little bit more as a normal price, but when anybody on TPT bundles things together, we give a discount. So this is pretty steeply discounted. The normal bundle price is $22.50. And for those who, and so here's the Power Up Learning with Task Card. So only one person's going to win it, and there are over 200 of you in here. So if you don't win it, Rachel and I put our bundles for 20% off through the end of the day Saturday. I normally just do my 20% off webinar bonus for 2 hours after the webinar, but because of all the mix-ups with the time and everything, we just decided we'll just let it go through Saturday to give you time to take a look at that. And then Rachel, I can still be in control of the keyboard, but if you want to say anything about your bundle, and then I'm just going to bring that picture in there too, so you can talk about that and let them know where to find that.
Great. One of the things that I love about working with Laura is we're very complementary in our approach, because Laura has all these games, so many wonderful ways to use task cards, and me, for the most part, I just make task cards. And so that's what this bundle is. It's 10 sets of task cards. It's mostly English language arts and reading. There are two math ones. So it's kind of a great starter set, a variety pack. It's aimed at a third, fourth, fifth grade. And then also in there, so the task card handbook is free, but I put it in there so that if you buy this, you don't have to go find it. You can find it. It's actually my featured free item in my TPP store. The task card handbook covers, one of the things it covers that we didn't cover is storage. So I know that people have questions about storage, and there's some great ideas about storage in there and some other ideas about using task cards. So I hope you'll go find the task card handbook. And again, I have discounted mine the same as Laura's, same deal.
Okay. And I was looking at that discount, Rachel, and I was like, you know, that's just almost like half off. You know, that's very close to, that's a pretty good deal for the webinar. I was just looking over at the questions, and it's someone we don't know who, but thank you, whoever said that was the fastest 2 hours ever. Well done, ladies. That makes us feel great, because it is a long time and we are approaching 2 hours now. And I saw somebody told me they're signed up for the summer conference already, so I'm excited about that too. Okay, so here it is. Here's the page where you're going to enter the giveaway. It's also the page with all the freebies on it. So the URL is at the top, and Amy, I believe, is going to put that in the chat. She's kind of helping out here behind the scenes, and she just did that. So if you, there should be a place there where you see a link in the question or chat area. I don't know what it's called from the viewer side, but you, I would also recommend that you write this down on your handout paper. One thing I did on the handout paper is I put the whole first part of the URL, laurakandler.com/webinars, lowercase, because when I didn't do that, people were typing it in wrong. A lot of people think my name is Chandler. It's not Chandler, it's Candler. And there was just confusion, so I was like, I'm going to write that whole thing out, and then all they have to do is put the keyword at the end, which is task cards. And if you go to that page, you see where the green arrow is. We'll leave the entry form open till 10:30 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, so that's a little more than a half an hour. That should be time for you to get over there and enter the giveaway. And then if you want to do the Facebook part, just go on over to Teaching Resources Facebook page and you know, comment about the webinar, and then when you go into the form, it will just ask you, like, what's your Facebook name or whatever. And then Rachel and I are going to hang around here for the next, you know, 15 minutes or whatever, and kind of scan through those questions and answer any questions that you have.